Professor Jung's The Evolution Theory from the Viewpoint of Christianity, The Thorough Analysis of the Descent or Origin of Man, Lecture 26, Chapter 17, Secondary Sexual Characters of Mammals. Male quadrupeds which are furnished with tusks use them in various ways, as in the case of horns. Thus, camels, guanacos, chevrotains, and musk deer are hornless, and they have efficient canines. These teeth being always of small size in the females than in the males. The camelidae have, in addition to their true canines, a pair of canine-shaped incisors in their upper jaws. Male deer and antelopes, on the other hand, possess horns and they rarely have canine teeth. Tusks and horns are manifestly of high importance to their possessors, for their development consumes much organized matter. With deer, in which the horns are periodically renewed, the drain on the constitution must be great. With mammals, when, as is often the case, the sexes differ in size, the males are almost always larger and stronger. It is polygamous seals, the males of which are well known to fight savagely together, that the sexes differ much in size, the monogamous species differing but little. Male quadrupeds are also more courageous and pugnacious than the females. There can be little doubt that these characters have been gained partly through sexual selection, owing to a long series of victories by the stronger and more courageous males over the weak, and partly through the inherited effects of use. It is probable that the successive variations in strength, size, and courage, whether due to male variability or to the effects of use, by the accumulation of which male quadrupeds have acquired these characteristic qualities, occurred rather late in life, and were consequently to a large extent limited in their transmission to the same sex. Choice in pairing by either sex of quadruped. Does the female prefer any particular male either before or after the males may have fought together for supremacy, or does the male, when not a polygamist, select any particular female? The general impression amongst breeders seems to be that the male accepts any females, and this owing to his eagerness is, in most cases, probably the truth. Whether the female, as a general rule, indifferently accepts any male is much more doubtful. In the 14th chapter on birds, a considerable body of direct and indirect evidence was advanced, showing that the female selects her partner, and it would be a strange anomaly if female quadrupeds, which stand higher in the scale and have higher mental powers, did not generally or at least often exert some choice. The female could, in most cases, escape if wooed by a male that did not please or excite her, and when pursued by several males, as commonly occurs, she would often have the opportunity, whilst they are fighting together, of escaping and some one male, or at least of temporarily pairing with him. On the courtship of the eared seals, Captain Bryant says as follows. Many of the females on their arrival at the island where they breed appear desirous of returning to some particular male, and frequently climb the outlying rocks to overlook the rookies, calling out and listening as if for a familiar voice. Then, changing to another place, they do the same again. As soon as a male reaches the shore, the nearest male goes down to meet her, making meanwhile a noise like the clucking of a hen to her chickens. He bows to her and coaxes her until he gets between her and the water so that she cannot escape him. Then his manner changes, and with a harsh growl, he drives her to a place in his harem. This continues until the lower row of harems is nearly full. Then the males higher up select the time when their more fortunate neighbors are off their guard to steal their wives. When the space is all filled, the old male walks around complacently reviewing his family, scolding those who crowd or disturb the others, and fiercely driving off all intruders. This surveillance always keeps him actively occupied. A clergyman who has bred many pigs asserts that souls often reject one boar and immediately accept another. From these factors, there can be no doubt that with most of our domesticated quadruped, strong individual antipathies and preference are frequently exhibited, and much more commonly by the female than by the male. This being the case, it is improbable that the union of quadrupeds in a state of nature should be left to mere chance. It is much more probable that the females are allured or excited by particular males who possess certain characters in a high degree than other males. But for these characters are, we can seldom or never discover with certainty. Shalom.